What's up, guys? We are here driving on our way to New York City, downtown Manhattan, Lower East Side. Gonna go meet up with our guy, Action Bronson. We connected over at the Knicks game. Not the first time I met him. Super nice dude from New York. He's from Queens. I'm from Long Island. Queens is on Long Island. So all my Queens and Brooklyn people, y'all really from Long Island. You heard? So we're about to connect. We're about to do some content stuff right now. I think we're gonna be doing his show, Funk That's Delicious. You know, obviously it's not called Funk. I just don't want to curse because YouTube, you know, this algorithm stuff. Shout out Nerd Focus. But we're going to do a short little segment, mix it up for you guys. This is going to be a whole day of vlogging, but we're going to have some questions asked and answered that people were asking on the Twitterverse. And let's get it going. So let's see what the first one is. Jake, Mr. Jacob Foyne.
You forgot something.
What did I forget?
The best camera guy.
Jacob Foyne. Nah, I can't give you that. I can't give you too much. I can't big him up too much, right,
you
guys?
You already said it.
Guys, I can't big him up too much.
Stop saying it. How does it feel to be the one to finally end the hyped up Sugar Show?
Man, this division has been played with sugar for way too long. It's time I take this division out to the dentist and just get this cavity removed. This is going to be a great fight. I think people are writing Sean off a little more than they should. And don't get me wrong, I do think on paper I have the better skill set, but I can't wait to go out there and prove that even with a guy as dangerous of a striker as him and all the other high-level strikers that I've faced in the past, that wrestling trumps all, especially when you're using good timing, good conditioning, and you just have the will and desire to win. I think this one's going to be not easy, but I do think after this I will be Mr. Four-Time Funk Master. Four-Time Funk.
Do you plan to get bigger if you move to featherweight or enjoy the benefits that come with an easier cut?
Definitely plan on getting bigger, and not bigger like I want to gain an extra 10 pounds, but I could let my body fill out. I could eat more. I could lift more. I could lift a little bit heavier. I don't want to lose what I have. That's going to be my advantage, which is my speed, my conditioning, and my grappling. And like, obviously I'm going to lose the stuff in the physical department in terms of like my reach advantage, my height advantage over most of the bantamweights. I'm not that tall, 5'7", guys. But at featherweight, I'm going to lose that. Like, even the guy who just fought Evloev Lopez on short notice, like, he was a tall dude. I think he's like 5'11", 6 feet tall, fighting at 145. So I'm going to be fighting some monsters. But with that being said, I think I'm going to have the luxury of being able to be more active. And I think my fight style might not be plagued as much as it is cutting down to 135. Like, I think I do well at 35, but I do think I lose a little bit cutting down as well. And I think the best of me in terms of my skill set and abilities is usually seen in the gym, but we're also wearing shin pads, bigger gloves. So maybe that's a false sense of security based on those protective things versus when it's just bone on bone, getting up in there, all the way up in there. Pause. Whole lot of pause.
What are your thoughts on what Tim Welch said about you on Ariel's show the other day?
Damn, I didn't hear the whole thing, but there was a part where he was talking to somebody. Oh, it was the Brett Okamoto. So I didn't hear the one that he did with Ariel yet. I got to play that. Maybe we'd listen to that on the way back home. But if it's anything to do about the weight cut, then I think these guys are freaking vagines. Like, you're openly saying, like, yeah, I'm the most dangerous guy, but at the same time, you're like, well, he's going to have a really tough weight cut, and we pretty much want to take advantage of that weight cut that he's going to have to do again, because we know he gets really big and it's going to be really difficult to yo-yo up like that and to come back down. And then on top of that, we know he's still going to be banged up coming out of this fight with Henry. That's some soft-ass shit. If I'm fighting somebody, I want to fight the best of the best, and I want to fight them when they are at their best. Maybe that's naive of me, because obviously the name of the game is to win and collect the paychecks any way possible. So maybe that's a naive way, but these guys are openly saying like, hey man, we're Vagines. We want the easiest version of Aljo. We know he's dangerous, but this is the easiest way we can get him. Let's take it and run with it. I guess that's one way to look at it, right? But I'm going to smash that boy regardless.
Why do you think Dana never liked you? He has rarely said a positive word when speaking about you.
See, I don't want to go back and forth with the Dana thing anymore because I think the media is making this more than what it was meant to be. This was just me saying my piece and clearing the air on the step-by-step order of events. Literally, I fought. Dana never makes fights the night of the fight. Some reason he made fights the night of the fight, and there was never a second of, hey, let me call him or talk to him in the back room. There was never any of that. Let's check on his injuries or see how he's feeling and see if he's in for this. It was never anything like that. It was just more so like, I would always be down, but it would be nice if I at least had some consultation beforehand so that we have a script or a narrative that we're going to run with as business partners. Because at the end of the day, we are business partners. Whether he likes it or not, it's just the name of the game, especially when you're in this position, right? So I don't want to go back and forth on that. I just had to say my piece on it. Because I ain't no bitch. Ain't nobody about to sit here and clown me. And I'm not saying he was clowning me, but ain't nobody going to sit here and make me look like I'm soft or ducking or being difficult or being a drama queen. Like, dude, I think I'm one of the realest guys out there. Like, honestly, I keep it straight, 100 every single time I talk. I don't play none of these stupid-ass games. And I don't be trying to leverage nobody on top of each other or anything like that. So if you can't respect that, then I don't know what to tell you, man. If you want to play games and do all this other shit, then go find some of these other clown shows to go work with. So I don't know if Dana doesn't like me. In the behind the scenes, dude, he's always great to me. He's giving me advice on my personal family stuff and good advice on how to keep my money and things like that. So it's like, I can't say Dana's a bad guy. I really can't. But in terms of just giving me a fair shake in the press, maybe because I'm not Conor. And we've seen Dana go one way with the fighter and then completely 180 with the next way. And then he'll go do a 180 again. It's just, he's a promoter. This is what he does. And he's going to do whatever's in the best interest of the company and himself. And I get that. At least I get that. But again, I'm going to say my piece on my platform and give you guys the goods and the Carfax and let you know exactly what. All right, guys, we just pulled up a couple blocks away from Action Bronson Studio. I'm not going to show you guys exactly where it's at because that would just be plain old wrong. Can't be giving up the goods like that. That'd be messed up. One of the things we did not touch on, though, was the BMF title being up for grabs again. Justin Gaethje, Dustin Poirier 2. The first one was a barn burner. We watched that fight all over again. And it was a great matchup, man. And it was a 5-round fight. Went almost 4 rounds. I think it was stopped like a minute into the 4th round. Poirier landed a nasty left hand right on the chin. And from there, put on the finishing touches. Gaethje waving him in. It was just violence from beginning to end. And that's the type of fights that these guys bring to the octagon. Me, my ass ain't fighting like that. You're going to have to force me to fight like that. And the only way you can do that is you got to stop my takedowns and punch me in the face. So with these guys, they agreed to let's stand in the center. Let's trade some punches. Kick the crap out of each other's shins and calves and legs. Yo, what else could you ask for? So I'm excited to see this fight again. And the only thing that concerns me is whoever wins this fight is supposed to get the next title shot, technically. Well, not supposed to. You would think that they would. But then you had the Makhachev situation where he fought in February against Volkanovski. Really close fight. After rewatching the fight, I kind of had it a draw with Volkanovski edging the fight, but not like which way you could be like it's a robbery, not like that. You could give the fight to Islam and I wouldn't have a problem with that. You know, he won. So now he's fighting in October. That's the problem. Because you got Darius fighting Charles Oliveira. Whoever wins that next month in June is supposed to fight in October, I think, right? In October against Islam.
Yeah.
So whoever wins that fights, and I guess whoever wins between Poirier and Gaethje should be the next person in line. And hopefully that is what we get. And hopefully this fight doesn't get postponed anymore. It's given Islam a ton of time to recover. And then you got this one, Dariush and Charles. That's a great fight. But the thing about this fight that I love about it the most is how much damage these guys did to each other. Like, I ain't fighting like that. I ain't gonna sit in the middle of the octagon saying like, let's kick the crap out of each other's legs and punch each other in the face and just like, you're gonna have to force me to fight like that. I don't care. My style is to grapple, take your ass down, inflict damage on you. You put little damage on me. That's the fight game. Hit without being hit. And I know people love this type of style because it's back and forth. Not rivalry, but back and forth over war. And that's always fun to watch. I'm a big fan of both these guys. I can't wait to watch. Gaethje says he only has so many fights left that he wants to just make one more title run. And after that, he's probably hanging it up, which I agree with him. He's been through wars. And the first fight was so crazy where Poirier lands his beautiful left hand right on the chin of Gaethje. Gaethje waves him in. Dustin slips, rips, puts the finishing touches on him, and the fight's over. Puts him away in a crazy highlight reel fashion. And I feel like both guys, Poirier hasn't been as active as Gaethje leading up to this rematch. Dustin beating Chandler in November. They're fighting in what, July? In Salt Lake City in July. So that's a long ways away. And I think Gaethje's last opponent was Fazeev. I forget exactly when that was, but that was a barn burner of a fight. So my point is, this is a great fight for the fans. Like, no matter what happens, they're going to win. And between the first fight and coming into this one, I think we've seen a lot of growth. Gaethje taking his time, using the jab a lot more, establishing his range before just winging punches. Where if you watch the first fight, you can see Gaethje just kind of covering up and just ripping these calf kicks, ripping these leg kicks. And then same thing, taking these punches, ducking his head, and then trying to find his target and swing these haymakers, occasionally connecting. Now he's a lot more polished, a lot more accurate, taking his time. And that could be problematic. But for the most part, listening to Poirier talk, he feels like Gaethje is still relatively the same, just a little bit better. And that's very interesting to me because I wonder if I compare that fight to Poirier. I think Poirier has been steadily increasing, but just being more efficient. The Chandler fight, that fight with Gaethje, and the other fights in between. I think this is a great showcase opportunity for him to see who's made the most progress in between. Because whoever wins this is one of those, both guys are older, towards the end of their career, trying to make as much money as they possibly can, put on the last few memorable fights that they possibly can, and make one more title shot run to become a world champion, undisputed world champion, both interim champs, but an undisputed world champion. And they're both so close. And this is why I hate but love this fight, because it's all on the line. But I hate that either man has to lose, because I think they both deserve an opportunity to fight for that world title again. So stay tuned for this one. I think Poirier has got the cleaner boxing. But again, Gaethje has made those adjustments, now utilizing the jab, taking his time with all his strikes. And I think that could be the difference. But we also said the same thing about Chandler using his wrestling against Poirier. Remember, I gave that an assessment. Chandler tried to wrestle a little bit. Then the last time he tried to wrestle, hits a big takedown where now he overshoots himself. Poirier capitalizes, puts on the finishing touches, and gets Chandler out of there. And we have a very similar situation. He finished Chandler, right? I think he finished him. Rear naked choke. Okay. I was like, make sure I'm not talking on my ass here. Yeah, there's a lot of fights up in here, guys. Sometimes I forget. We ain't all perfect. I don't really review notes as much as I used to, because I'm just always like this. But yeah, I think it's going to be a great fight, and I'm excited. BMF title on the line. What the fuck does that even mean? I don't know. This is what Dana does. It's kind of in line of like the gimmicky thing that he says he doesn't do, but I'm here for it. I used to like the WWE, which is the gimmicks. So I'm here for it. As a fight fan, I'm here for it. It's two high level guys. Whether there's a belt on the line, made up or not, I'm going to watch. You don't need to sell me on the BMF title. We could just say the title without even giving a title. And this is just to be the undisputed baddest motherfucker in the division. And I'm here for it. So let's see who's going to cause the most chaos and who's going to get their hand raised. Will Dustin Poirier go up 2-0? Or will he even the score from Justin Gaethje and make it one apiece? Find out next time on UFC. Have a time to nod. Sure, you keep that burner tuck, cause they like to creep low. Say motherfucker, the PO in the judge. But if they come with us, just know it's love. I'm saying just because. Damn, man. Fuck, that was delicious. You see what I did there?
Yo, I saw you brought a nerd focus just for you.
Oh my goodness, again. How do I keep doing this?
This is crazy.
I'm a mental midget, I guess. Not in the cage, but outside of the cage, clearly. Because how do you botch two premieres of your drink and not bring it for the guests? But we fixed it with Ariel. We actually sent him a case.
I saw that.
Yeah, so he got a couple cases for free because of my blunder. And I think I'm going to have to hook these guys up too. Not think. I'm gonna try to hook these guys up for sure. But that was fun, man. We had a good time. And
I wish I didn't eat all the Greek food I ate this morning, because I would have more room to eat more French pizza. That was actually really good. The one with the ham was like, who thinks of this? Like, I wouldn't put that together. Not like ham and pizza, yeah, but the way he did it, the French bread with the pizza, with the ham, with the olive oil that was like $200 for a small little thing like this, which was nuts. Some real like organic ingredients.
And he was like a super chef, like, yeah, bro, he's like a genius rapper and a chef.
Yeah,
like, he's a very talented person.
That's nice, that was good. I ain't passing judgment, I'm just on some love. All this ignition is in me trying to rise above it. Instead of trying to stand for something, die for nothing. But can hit the liquor soap, go buy me something. If can hit the man, we need a dime or something. I'm saying just because. Yeah. Cause we've been coming from welfare, Medi-Cal, healthcare. Living in the hood is hell here, hell yeah. What a day it has been. Somehow we went from the car to Action Bronson. Now we're back at the crib. And I don't know if you guys heard the Tim Welch interview with Ariel Helwani, but I thought it was a pretty interesting piece. Like, overall, it was good, insightful, but also makes me realize a little bit of the delusion that some people have. And I'm not saying there's anything wrong with having faith in your guy, because obviously I would hope that everyone would have faith in me, Marab, and like others on the team. Like, yeah, that's the way it should be. But sometimes when people say certain things and it sounds like they believe everything that they're saying, it gets really wacky. Specifically, what I'm talking about is Tim Welch saying, like, when Ariel asked him, does he think that the UFC would rather him be the face of the bantamweight division or be the champ?
Sean. The face, yeah.
And I agree. I do think that the UFC does want that. But then when he started going into like his reasonings of why and start calling himself like this knockout artist, and not saying he never knocked anybody out, but it's just very different now that he's swimming with the big boys in the deep end. We just haven't quite seen this magic knockout, wannabe knockoff from McGregor. You know what I mean? Like, that was like the trajectory that he was on. But for some reason, it's just like people just don't got the formula or the juice to be Conor.
Yeah, like there's like guys that they try to use that formula with, but none of them ever panned out like Conor, except for Conor. Like, the only one who actually became like champion and then double champion was Conor.
I think the coolest thing about Conor like coming up was just like he kind of backed up everything he said. Yeah. He did like whoever they put in front of him, he did like KO, and he did the right thing. Like, he did his job every time. I think what you were kind of asking was like who was the last person Sean like KO'd? Was that Eddie Wineland? Like, actually, like, KO'd. Like, I know he did TKO Moutinho. He did, they touched up a
but
lot.
But he
of
was still, like, standing. When I mean, he, it wasn't, that was, like, a weird one.
Yeah, Moutinho was still going forward. It was just, like, the ref just the didn't ref want to see him get beat up
which
anymore.
Which is fair.
Yeah.
I get it. Which, but he didn't really stop. In fact, I mean, I think, I don't remember who the ref was for that one. I mean, Moutinho got beat up.
Dean.
He got beat up for 14 minutes and 45 seconds. Give the guy 15 seconds to at least get to a decision. Like, I think, like, that's.
Yeah, that was
think,
weird.
Yeah, I think it'd been right by the fighter, too.
That's, like, not really a traditional knockout. That's like,
or even a traditional TKO where the guy's covered up
he's forfeiting basically.
You're just like, oh well, you were just getting punched the whole time. Like, well, he was still swinging. He just was not being effective by not landing anything.
And if you watch Moutinho's next fight in the UFC, I think it was like into like a Guido Gannetti or something like that. I don't know why I remember that name. Like, he was, I thought that was real, like a more realistic stoppage. Like, he was actually rocked and like hurt in that one, and he was still standing, but O'Malley one, he was moving forward and like almost like, what the hell? Why'd you stop it now of all times? Like, what was the difference? So before that, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I don't even know who O'Malley, who he's knocked out, who's still in the UFC. Like,
I don't know anyone who's knocked out.
Nobody.
Like,
the only guy.
Is Piva still in the roster?
Maybe.
Piva might be the only guy. Thomas Almeida, Eddie Wineland.
I thought.
And Piva, I thought.
Maybe he is still.
I think maybe just Piva.
I mean, but knock that guy in the contender series. No, like, he's got, he clearly has a.
He can knock guys out.
100%.
On the like, level. Yeah. But then as soon as he entered the top 15, it was
big,
like.
Though, is what we said. Like, no disrespect. Like, I give respect. I think it's pretty noticeable that I give respect where it's due, right? Mm-hmm. So I go, anytime this man has stepped in there with a shark in the deep end, he's been chewed up for the most part every single time. Yeah. And let me, okay, maybe not say chewed up. Well, Cheeto, he got flatlined. He, you ever see a domino, how you just topple it over and it just falls and it goes, meh.
That no, was but him. Dude, that was his injury.
That's terrible.
He's still undefeated, I forgot.
Bro, it's not even a real loss.
Yeah, it's not, you know, because he kicked his leg. Dude, you lost. You stepped in there, you didn't get your hand raised.
That's the deal.
You lost.
That was the deal, always.
It's like, what I want to tweet to Henry right now, like him still talking about this and saying like whatever about the fight, and I just want to go like, bro, you lost. And just leave the dots.
I mean, who the hell is Henry like, what are we talking to about? Dictate anything, by the way? Like, respectfully, the guy stepped away for three. I loved what Dominic Cruz said about it. He's like, dude, you forfeited. You left, all right? Everyone else was fucking scrapping out here. And you were like, all right, I really don't want to do that anymore. So I'm out. Like, no, you don't get to come back and dictate anything. Like,
and then cut the line.
Everybody.
Yo, like, but somehow he did.
No, he did. But like, what Dominic Cruz was saying, that he does not agree with that. That's
no,
not a real
no,
champion.
I know. But I'm saying it's crazy that Henry, it's actually an accomplishment in itself that he was able to get himself back into a title shot.
You know what I think is more impressive?
No, not that it's like, I'm saying he's so good at speaking that it's like,
I disagree. I think respectfully,
yeah, I don't think that had
I think the reason they put his Cejudo in there was to murk this man out. That was the only, respectfully.
I don't want to back kept talking and talking and talking and talking about it until it actually happened.
Because I was cheering for how
I'm not saying it's like, you guys are misunderstanding. I'm not articulating it well, but I'm saying it's like, I'm kind of mocking it as if like, somehow
it doesn't sound like you're mocking it at all.
Well, look, here's the thing too. Like, I don't think it was like GSP. I don't know. Like when he got in there to like fight Bisping, I was like,
it's like we all knew what was up. It's just like, yo, bro,
we know what the deal is.
When Weidman was a champion, you didn't have no desire 100%. Or inclination to want to come back.
If Yoel Romero won that belt, you'd think GSP respectfully was gonna fight Yoel Romero. No. I love GSP. He's one of my favorite all-time fighters.
He's smart.
That's insanity.
Like what I'm getting at is like how Henry put out a video today and about him like
taking himself in the news cycle.
Like I'm saying that. He's good at that. That's like his thing that's been keeping him in the limelight.
His YouTube channel, all that stuff.
Yeah, but that's right now. You're talking about the current with that particular example. What we're talking about is beforehand. He was literally hanging out on the sideline waiting for an opportunity that seemed right. And even when I won the belt, he was saying like, he doesn't think I'm the best guy in the division. And at that point, he felt more comfortable that he's going to be like, you know what? I'm going to call the comeback because at this point, I feel like the guy who's holding the belt isn't really the best guy in the world. I still think it's me, and I still think I could go in there and beat this guy because I think it's easy money.
Well, he thought it was a very winnable fight.
Easy money. You see what I'm saying? And and this is what I respect about Dom, because Dom gets it. You took yourself out of the competition when it got tough, meaning you would have had to fight the next number one contender. Had he had stayed in the pool, his next guy he would have fought would have probably been Piotr Jan, or because he beat that 42-year-old skateboarder at the time, so he probably would have had to have gotten to fight PD, or Jose Aldo, if Aldo had won that fight coming off of a loss.
Or yourself after that. Like, because you beat Sandhagen at the time.
Yeah, I'm just saying. Like,
but there are like a lot of
these
hungry
are killers,
young. Yeah, 100%.
Bro.
That's it.
Yeah.
5'11", Sandhagen. Like, he didn't want to fight none of those guys. But going back to what we were saying originally is the fact that O'Malley, anytime he's fought the top of the competition, like, he had a really questionable win over Piotr Jan. And again, I know people said my fight with him was close, but they were two polar opposites of close. Like, he did nothing to me. I did everything to him.
To Jan.
Yeah, to Jan. And then you have them with O'Malley and Jan having this really close fight where
like a different
no
close.
One really knows who really won the fight. Because
they
so
They both hurt
down
each other so much.
So bad.
Yeah.
There's no like, well, you could give it to him because of this. Well, you can make the same points of that argument and give it to the other guy.
Yeah.
And give him, like, we just watched it again and not trying to be biased. I was like, damn, what was I watching when we did our breakdowns? Like, I feel like Jan won this fight. But then again, I'm like, am I being biased because he gave him a Robert's jacket? I'm like, I don't know. So,
I mean, I think if you listen, I mean, look, when I watched the fight, I thought I gave it to Jan 3-0. I know even like the third round, the knee, I get it, all that stuff. But
that was one shot.
That was one shot.
And the judges are supposed to ignore the blood, even though it is damaged. But that's very hard to do. And outside of that one knee, I still think Jan was more successful with the strikes landed in round three after we watched it again.
I mean,
and that's where my brain is just like, I don't even know who won this fight.
I just thought he out-MMA'd him. He out-wrestled him. He out-boxed him.
He did more.
I feel like
he just
did more damage.
I'm like, come on. Like, what are we doing here? Like, this sucks. Like, I mean,
more damage. I see the cut was a big cut. So it's hard to say damage.
No, like, I'm saying I feel like Jan landed more throughout the fight.
So yeah, he landed more strikes, more significant strikes. Yeah,
that's what I'm saying.
If you want to make it like close between that, then he landed the takedowns too. So I think that should add something. If it's like a close between like strikes and everything, then I think we should have to look at the other factors. Who got the takedowns? I thought Yan got the takedowns. He fucking landed that schoolboy trip again. I'm like, God damn, that's wild. Like,
yeah. But then if you come back into the classroom after going into the bathroom to scrap and you come back and everyone looks at your face and then you see one guy with a gash, you just kind of assume that guy got beat.
That's true. Yeah. No, you're right.
So it's like, it's weird.
That's a tough one.
Tough situation. But then he had that struggle with Yan. I'm not saying it wasn't a good fight. Great performance. It showed that O'Malley is the real deal. Mm. And not that he's the real deal, that he can compete.
Absolutely.
I think the kid's freaking good. I'm not knocking the guy whatsoever. And then he fought, but before that, he fought Pedro. Not eventful. My fight with Pedro was action from bell to bell the entire time. I think we set the record for strikes landed between the two of us. Well, me, really, on him. But
wow. What was that ungodly knockout power in that fight, though? Like, where was
exactly
that? Like,
He did the spin around where he.
Yeah, no, like he looked like he was he looked like he was exactly what he is. Like, moves well. He does a lot very well.
And so when we're breaking down the fights, getting ready for the matchup, and this is for the viewers as well, these are the things that we look at to try to give us apples to apples. So we're not just pulling shit out of our ass and just being biased, because when you do that, that's where you lose the fight. And even like with Henry, I said, I feel like these guys watch my fight instead of watching, like, why can't this guy who I think is this good, why can't he do the things that he was doing to these other guys who are really good? Mm-hmm. There's got to be something there that I'm missing. And, there was something, I forgot which fighter there was. There's somebody, I think it was Bisping. Someone said something that there was, Rashad Evans said something about Bisping. He's like, I feel like I watched him. I don't want to use the wrong words, but he almost said like he sucked or he didn't think he was that good or couldn't hang. Mm. But then for some reason he was in a fight with him and he was just like, how is this guy still here with me? But I think guys get that same feeling with me where they feel that. But going back to O'Malley, that fight with Pedro, not eventful, poked the guy's eyes out, Edward Scissorhands, or O'Malley's sugar hands.
Wow.
Digs out his eyeballs, and then goes on social media and starts acting like he won. And then on top of that, like...
Well, he got a bigger fight off of that, too, which is absurd to me. I mean, like...
Crazy.
Way he jumped the line.
That's... I mean, look, it's cool, but now I was wrong.
But now he gets the ass whooping he deserves!
Going back to what we started with.
I'm a villain. Drink Nerd Focus.
I like the Nerd Focus. Yo, big fan of the Nerd Focus. The Tim Welch interview, which is, I think, what we started with, by the way.
But last thing. So, Cheeto killed him, toppled him over like a domino. Pedro Munhoz, Edward Sugar O'Malley hands, raked his eyes out. And then a very eventful fight with Piotr Jan that no one really actually believes that he won, even though it was close. And I think you could give him the nod, but it wasn't something that's super spectacular. Like we were saying, like Conor, like, so when Tim Welch was saying that he thinks that the UFC wants this flashy knockout artist, I'm like, but where's the flash been? Like, if we're being honest, where's the flash been? People knock on me. It's like, can you finish a goddamn fight instead of hugging people's back? I'm like, at least I'm not lying to you, telling you, like, I'm going to put his lights out, dude. I'm going to fucking put his lights out, bro. That's what I'm going to tell you, dude. It's, yeah, I'm going to go out there and just, you know, he's going to leave his chin. You see the way he holds his chin? I'm going to put his lights out. I'm not doing that. I'm telling you exactly what I'm doing. I'm coming for that ass. Literally. Pause. But I am.
No, I just says it. He'll scum you. He does it in Super Smash Bros. He does it in every video. He does it in everything we do, really. He'll just...
The path of least resistance,
he'll
baby.
He'll do it. No. It's absurd what he'll do. That's what I'm saying. Like, get in there with it. It's fucking absurd. Like, no, you're right. Like, even, you know, listening to Longo on Luke Thomas's interview.
I'm like more than halfway done with that.
No, I thought it was good. But like at one point they mentioned, I was like, why do these fighters keep...
underestimating me.
Yeah. And I mean, Longo kind of like, because he doesn't... He does Aljo. He just does what he does, and you're looking at it like, I think I see some holes in there. I think I could, like, but it's like, all right, man, I just go do it.
Come fill these holes there, son.
Wow.
And he says stuff like that. You're like, all right, come on. Like, how ridiculous is this guy?
Pause.
When I say holes, I mean these, like the punches.
When you really think about what you just said.
You put up a shield.
No, don't touch me, bro. That's crazy.
I'm saying, like, the hole.
Come on, man.
See, look, there's a hole right there. I'm filling the
you
hole.
You better start clipping these things.
Yeah,
right?
This is
clipping.
Crazy.
Pause. Yeah,
should be real.
He said, come here, son. Fill these holes. Pause.
Fill these holes, B. You got what it takes, my boy.
I thought the Tim Welch interview was good overall. Like Aljo said, though. Let's go back to that point.
I don't like the... I'm not a fan of the Tim Welch interview.
This? I thought it was very...
Red Hawk.
I thought it was very interesting. I didn't know he had a relationship with some of the other coaches before. Was it like Robert Follis? He mentioned he like lived with him. I mean, I didn't know he had a...
John Crouch.
Yeah. I knew with the John Crouch because of the Arizona thing, but I didn't know. But it's interesting. You just get to learn more about these guys and get more insight than I think they expect to reveal.
I think they're very inexperienced.
Ultimately, yeah. I mean, yeah,
from that whole thing.
And to be fair, he admitted as much too. Like at one point, Ariel, come on, man. He's like saying, like, do you consider yourself one of the great all-time coaches? I'm like, Ariel, why do you do stuff like that?
He's giving him the noose to tie himself.
That's crazy. Yeah, no. Like honestly,
What did he say to that?
No, but he did the right thing. He did the right thing. Yeah, okay, he's good. Like, now look, I haven't been in the game long like that. Like I haven't been. You know, these guys have been.
You
here
have
forever.
One guy.
Yeah, you have literally have one fighter who just like
who's been him. Like favored, highly blessed, and highly favored the whole way.
Look, it's I respect.
I was like, it would be nice. I wonder what it's like to be favored.
Like,
I have no idea.
Like I don't know what that looks like.
I mean, in life, I think I'm favored, so it's all good.
Doing great, Steve. You're doing great. But even when we were talking about like the Conor trajectory, like even though people can say whatever they want, oh, he fought Chad Mendes on short notice. Oh, he fought an older, over-the-hill Dennis Seaver. But he went out there and he knocked all these guys out who were ranked all the way through and even into the championship fight in 14 freaking seconds.
He actually knocked out Jose Aldo.
I'll tell you that broke my heart, but he did do what he did. I mean, that's
like,
incredible.
Paddy's not going to do that. Sean hasn't really done that.
All
these guys who they picked to do that trajectory with, Conor's the only one that actually did it.
Even Paulo Costa who came in.
Oh, they did.
You know what? Izzy actually panned out kind of.
But Izzy wasn't.
I don't know if you could put him in that same category.
I would say Izzy's the only one who was able to semi-replicate what Conor did in terms of an impact. The only thing he didn't have was the perfect dance partner with a rivalry. Mm-hmm. And we thought it was going to be Pereira, which it was good. But I don't think it was at the magnitude that it was Conor.
But I do think it did. I did think it brought him up. Because he was already
it made
I think,
him bigger for being
100%. No, like, that's crazy. Yep, and then winning. That's incredible.
But that win was sick.
Insane.
It was epic.
That's what I'm saying.
And just the ending was just like,
it's crazy. It took him a little longer to get that.
How about that 0-3? Like, I don't know. Sick. In any fight history, I don't know if someone would like can comment on this. Like, has anyone been 0-3, getting knocked out in the last two and come back on, I guess, the fourth?
Probably
like,
not.
How insane is that?
Not at that level.
Knocked out twice. Once, but that one was a knockout. That one was more like a standing TKO.
I get it. But he was still,
I still thought it was an early stoppage. But
I could argue an early
stoppage. In that moment,
Dr. Stoppage!
Oh, my God. That's pretty good.
Conor just gives us the goods, man, from like kind of standpoint of the game.
Well, that's unfortunate. His entire existence is a meme now. Like anything he does, even that picture of him Chandler's face. I don't know why he looks like that. He looks unwell. No offense, Conor, you're awesome or whatever.
But he actually became double champ.
No, he did.
He actually became regular. He was interim champ, then double champ. And none of these guys have done that.
Yeah.
I will say, respect to Izzy. I thought. And I don't mean this disrespectful to Eddie Alvarez, but I thought Eddie Alvarez was a very favorable matchup for Conor at the time. Even when they announced the fight, I'm like, if anybody he's beating at lightweight for the belt, unfortunately, Eddie Alvarez is the guy.
He was at the moment. Nate Diaz.
Izzy had the same opportunity against Jan Blachowicz. He still could have beaten Jan Blachowicz, I believe, but...
I don't know.
That's a tough... You say no shot?
The guy was like 195 pounds.
That was crazy.
Which I didn't understand. Or 200. Silly like that.
I thought it was a winnable fight. And, Jan fought brilliantly, unfortunately.
Yeah, until a guy grabs you for real and said, nah, bro, we ain't playing that striking shit.
He did that, the Jan Blachowicz fight, the night you fought Jan for the first time.
Yeah.
That was crazy.
And my fight was very, not inspiring on my part.
To be fair.
It was deflating.
It's not the outcome we hoped for, but
it worked out in the end, right?
Yeah.
Thank you.
But now we're here.
Comment, subscribe, baby. That's terrible.
Was there another fight announcement or
fight announcement? I mean, I heard rumors of Jamal Hill, Israel Adesanya. Do you know anything about anybody? Is that real? Nah.
There's no way.
No way.
No way.
Well, who is Jamal? I mean, is Yuri Prochazka whatever? Is he around?
I think that's the fight.
I mean, if he's healthy, I thought his shoulder.
I thought
was
they announced that one.
They had to the same thing, like they were just putting out posters, but I don't know if the UFC actually put that poster out.
All right.
No, I don't think the UFC actually posted
it. No, I think you're right on that. I didn't see anything like
somebody else. It's like one of those rumor sites.
But that's what I'm saying. Okay, how about this? Hypothetically, think about this, guys. Israel Adesanya beats Jamal Hill, Alex Pereira beats Jan Blachowicz. Third fight in MMA for the double belts, 205 belt. Come on, what's better than that? What's a better storyline than that, people?
That would actually be insane.
You're welcome. You're like welcome, Zuffa. Or no, whatever, UFC now.
Endeavor,
that's right.
That would actually be insane, dude.
But with, unfortunately, their luck, it'd probably like Blachowicz wins and Jamal Hill wins, and then they just get that again. I mean, yeah. You know, unfortunately, that's how that shit works out, guys, so.
Yeah, hopefully Jiri's shoulder gets better soon so that they can book that matchup, because I'm looking forward to seeing Jamal compete again and against Prochazka, who's such a wild card. It's a like fascinating stylistic matchup where it's just one guy is just crazy and the other guy's more technically sound, I think. I'm not saying Prochazka isn't technical, but it's like a
whirlwind.
Yeah.
I mean, he could run right into something too. Like, you don't know, but he could also catch you in.
I would like to watch him break down his fight and tell us.
No way.
Like, he knew he was going to do this because he was doing this, and see if he could even do that.
I don't think he's that guy, which I love, by the way. Huge fan of that. Chaos. Like, chaos. Absolute chaos. Like, I don't know. I'm sure some of it's like just, you know, 1,000% repped. He's repped it 1,000 times, whatever. But I mean, just probably repped madness. Like, I'm saying, like, I don't know if there's any like thought behind it necessarily. It's just like attack, 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 attack. What's up?
I'm coming.
All right, let's get some questions.
I'm trying to. The ones I screenshotted were terrible.
Good questions.
Well, actually, here's a funny one.
What time are we at?
20 minutes.
Okay.
Aljamain, when you were, if this is bad, we can cut this out, but okay, it's funny. Aljamain, when you're about to have sex, do you imagine Bruce Buffer announcing you as Aljamain the Fuckmaster Sterling? Someone actually asked you that.
No, but when it's almost time to go, I go, it's time!
Bill McCord. Five rounds. One short round.
One. Hey, I'm a five-round fighter, baby.
Yo.
We like to go to decisions.
Okay.
And I never give up the fifth round.
Jeez. Guy's a troll.
Yeah, I always give up the fifth round.
Stop saying these things.
Take it how you want.
That's it. 3-0, baby. That's it.
Why do these guys keep underestimating him? I don't know, Luke.
Because he says shit like this. He's like, I'll 3-2 anybody. I'm like, what? What? What'd you say?
Yo, when you break it down into the simplest terms, it's like you're fighting. Is a lot more simpler than we think. Yeah, it's still scary, but shit.
I saw somebody on Twitter.
He's got to win three rounds, baby.
I saw someone on Twitter say, like, Aljo's just, what was it? He's jailbroken the system or something like that. Now he's just a glitch in the game. I'm like, he's kind of glitching the game. Like,
you get the fire stick. You hack it.
He said, all right, I know the rules. Fuck it.
Somebody asked, how do you see the bantamweight division playing out outside of the top five? What I assume is, like, who do you think is coming up that's ranked but not in the top five yet? Like, how do you see that going?
I do wonder if I could see Rob Font ever breaking back into the top five. And then I do wonder if Ricky Simone could bounce back and stay within the top 10. And I do wonder if Adrian Yanez can bounce back and show that he can make adjustments and not get into too many firefights where, because I think he's just like, what it seems like, he's like the smaller guy. Like the Davy Grant fight, the fight with Rob Font. And then you got Umar and Nurmagomedov allegedly fighting Corey Sandhagen. And if they do fight, can Corey stop the wrestling and maintain his place to get a title shot, another shot at the title? This would be his like third title shot.
It?
Interim with Jan.
Oh, that was it though, wasn't it?
I mean, my fight with him was a title fight.
This motherfucker, that's why.
And then...
that was it, the interim with Jan.
And that was it.
It really was.
No, but in reality, the and fake the, lineal.
In real life.
Well, technically, you are the lineal champ now. That's crazy. Because you did beat Cejudo.
So you're the five-time champion. TJ.
I never lost my belt. Daddy's coming for that belt. Okay, TJ, thanks for coming. Aljamain's the Brenner champ. I never gave him the belt. I gave it away. I'm coming back. In my eyes, I'm the champion. Thanks for coming, Henry. The retirement center is down this way.
Aljo's low-key kind of like MJ. Like, he just takes everything. He takes it personal. Like, when you say these things, he does not forget.
And then I took that personally.
Every time. He's like...
And I took that shit personal.
How do you like training with Raul Rosas Jr.? Hashtag and still.
I mean, it was cool. The training was very drill oriented, so we didn't get to do too much together in the sense of like rolling or anything like that, where it's like an actual connection with competing with each other. You know, 'cause I feel like you have more of a bond when you actually go live against somebody, or you actually spar with them, or you wrestle with them live. Well, I guess it's kind of the same thing. But when it's kind of drilling, it's more like, it's just easy. It's more laid back. It's more fun and not as serious, maybe. I do drill kind of seriously for the most part.
I think you're really good at that.
So maybe I'm full of shit. Hey, it was cool. It was a cool kid. He's got a lot to learn, and I think that gave him a more better insight on how he should be training, and I think the sky's the limit for the kid.
I think we could end with this one, but who's the scariest opponent you ever faced?
Scariest opponent I ever faced?
That's actually a good question.
I let me answer it this way. The person who I was most afraid to fight, I'm gonna tweak their question a little bit. Afraid. Going into the fight, like afraid, nervous, scary to fight. Like when I say scary and afraid, it's kind of like one and the same synonymous with each other. Was Johnny Eduardo.
He had
just fought Eddie Wineland, knocked him out, broke his jaw.
Yeah, training. That's funny.
Knocked out Johnny Eddie Wineland. This is 2015, guys.
No, I remember, broke his jaw. Like this was a big Eddie Wineland thing, but that 8 years ago. Oh my God.
Yeah, and Eddie Wineland was a former champion, yep. WEC. Didn't really lose to too many people other than the top guys.
No, he lost to Burrell not that long before that. Like,
he fought for a world title.
Yeah, exactly. He was beating Burrell, by the way, whatever.
Yeah, he was. But he knocks out Eddie Wineland, but breaks his jaw. He trains with Nova Uñao, with Jose Aldo.
Killers.
He's Burrell. Actually his coach at the time with Burrell.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That
wow.
other guy, Johnny Nunez, Diego Nunez,
yes.
who was also training at 145, yep, yep. who was another killer from Nova Uñao.
These guys were all killing it back then.
Yeah, man. So it's like you see all these guys that they were training with and the damage he was doing in the division. He was a lot older, very technical striker. I didn't trust in my striking at all. And that fight, going into it, I remember going into the bathroom. I don't say I was having a panic attack, but it was like, I had to pump myself up to, I was like, dude, you gotta fucking go. You talked a lot of shit. Because I do this shit all the time.
So like what about it was the most intimidating?
I was like, yeah, you trying to get my jaw broken? Especially after all the shit I was talking, I was like, how am I going to talk shit if my jaw broke it? You know what I'm saying?
So, he was just like, I mean, that's like a...
I can't talk anymore if my jaw's broken.
It was just like a scary fight. Like
that was how Aljo's Twitter fingers were born.
Yeah.
He was like worried about fucking getting his jaw broken.
So, yeah, I was in the bathroom before we were about to make the walk, pumped myself up, and I said my motto, my little mantra that I always say to myself, even with the wrestling days back in high school, too fast, too strong, too quick, and it can't be broken. And that kind of reminded me of like all the stuff that I did and gave me confidence to that, yo, just go out there and do what you do in training. And then as I was moving, the first round was very boring. Cause I was gun shy. I was on my lateral footwork. I was in a fight by not fighting. I was no engaging. I did a front kick, a spinning back kick, yeah. and I got out of there. Almost like trying to shank him and go. Step, and then go. So then I pitter patter the fight. Like I'm just taking a kick, he tries to swing, he's swinging, just whiffing across my face. I'm like, yo. Then I take him down, he gets like a little frustrated because mm-hmm. he's like, yo, I can't keep this guy still.
The most frustrating fight style of all time.
Yes. And I learned this in sparring. Like even when we do those drills with Ray, and Ray would put us through those lateral footwork drills, I was working with Ally, Quinta all the time, Pumi or whoever else I was working with, Bowman. And I realized how frustrating that was when you're just moving side to side to track somebody down. It's almost impossible. As long as they can juke the shit out of you, you're not hitting that guy.
Yeah.
I don't care who you are, you're not hitting him. And then he got overzealous, took him down. Long story short, I passed his guard. I beat the crap out of him in the first round, elbowed him. And Matt and I were working on framing from the bottom. Fight week, bro.
That's
Matt and I didn't even have time to do this like during the camp. We did this fight week. Well, I'm cutting weight, and we just kept repping it. He's like, yo, if you get him down, he grabs your arms, overhook, I want you to step up, head position, pull the arm through, thumb down across the belly button, and then you get the other one out, and then slam the elbows. And I was just doing it with the one. He would loosen up the other one, and I came back with the other one, and there was one elbow I think I threw, I think it was a left hand, and I, as soon as I tapped him, I just say, pop! And, yo, when you hit somebody with this bone, bro,
that sounded crazy, right?
Yeah, it is crazy. Yo. And you hit someone's skull with that. I saw his eye. I think it was his cheekbone. I saw his cheekbone just go split. It was like a vagina.
a vagina?
This guy's ridiculous.
But in real time, just imagine I just go, bam. And I'm just watching your eye. And it was like a delayed reaction. Like I hit him, I'm looking, and then
Why does Aljo describe things like this?
But this is what it's looking like to me. I'm like, oh, I could do this. But this is, I'm very animated, guys. I'm sorry.
No,
I'm
remember that, but that, I'm not that like,
super like, unless we're like cool, you know, like, you know. But I'm like this sometimes.
That was a big showcase fight for you, though. Like, that was a, oh, that was a huge one.
My first press conference where I called out Brian Caraway, said, he's hiding behind Misha Tate's tits.
Man, why does he mention this stuff? We didn't have to, I knew that was right before the Caraway fight. Yeah. We didn't have to talk about that.
And then I lost that fight after I got that fight.
This guy just doesn't stop himself. I remember because we were watching both fights at the gym. The one where he choked out Eduardo.
Yeah.
We lost our fucking mind. That was a crazy one. Because that was, again, everyone knew that was a dangerous fight. Like, it wasn't like one of those, like, it's not dangerous in the sense like you're fighting a skilled guy, I guess. I don't know how to, like a Ben Askren where you're like, this motherfucker can beat me, you know? Like, no, this guy can kill you.
And
like,
hurt you
that's
bad.
That's a shitty, you know, thought process. You're like, all right, I can lose this fight. But I can get, like, I can lose this fight. Like, this is going to be a tough one, you know? Right. You know what I'm saying? Like,
the fights that could change you. It's like, if you're going to fight Justin Gaethje or you're going to fight Dustin Poirier.
Of course.
You know you are in for a fight. You fight an old school Tony Ferguson, or should I say winning streak Tony Ferguson. You know there's a chance you are getting sliced up no matter what you want to do about it.
Like, even if you win that fight, you know you're going to get damaged. Like, that's the deal. Like, I remember you kept talking about it before the Sandhagen fight. You were like, all right, like, I got to be prepared. I'm going to the hospital after this. Like, I'm going to be prepared to go to the hospital after this. Yeah. Like, you kind of almost have
to
go in.
That's a crazy thought process.
Like, no matter what, like, even win, lose, like, no matter how this goes, there's a very good chance I'm going to be very damaged going into
that
it.
That is crazy.
Luckily, it didn't work out like that. But, like, again, just, like, you kind of...
I thought we robbed Vegas. And my head was like, wow. I was impressed with myself. I was like...
Got a performance bonus. No, that's it. This guy's hilarious.
I was like, that's it? Nothing else? No. We go dancing, baby.
You didn't take it like
when
a champ.
When you meet Corey.
When I meet Corey. Yeah. Went to the club, there was bottles to the face. It was a good time.
You took it like a champ. I remember, I don't know if he told anyone.
We saw him later that night.
You know what's hilarious?
We had the same management.
Yep. I don't know why he never mentions. I think it's one of the funniest things that ever happened.
Yeah, I've never heard
so
this.
We're like, we're going up to going up to the, because it was during COVID time. Everyone stays in the same fighter hotel. Like
Renaissance Hotel.
Yeah. Everyone knows that one now. But, Aljo, it's like me, Aljo, Al, Dennis, like we're coming up with our bags. We just came from the press conference and like we just see Aljo's manager.
Like, we're all like talking about the fight, yeah, excited. And, like,
not even just talking, we're loud, fucking, literally what loud. He was doing. He's just dancing like, hey, hey, hey. And then like Sandhagen just like turns around because he was the one talking to his manager. Like turns around, sees all of us. We're like, hey,
It just,
just like
so
just dies. We're like, oh, that's crazy. Because we didn't know he was talking to him. We just saw him like talking to somebody. And then he's like, and then I think what he's saying is like, sup, assholes.
No way.
He didn't even mean it in like a mean-spirited way. Like, you know, he was just like, he did take it like a champ, though. So I always liked Sandhagen for that.
Yeah.
That was hilarious. Sorry about that. Like,
sorry.
That was crazy. But I don't know. I can't believe he never told that one.
I don't know. I felt like I thought I did, but I guess.
I don't think you've said that before.
Yeah, it was very awkward. And yeah, he was cool about it, but. I was like, damn, you just never know where you're going to be and who's going to be around.
I was very excited.
Wait, what did you actually do after that fight if it was COVID time?
We went to that club, Citizens.
Mm. There's a club open?
It was like a lounge.
Vegas had some stuff. Like, I mean, the rules were still weird. Like, you still technically were supposed to wear the mask. But like some places, like in every state, I'm assuming, we're like, dude, these rules fucking suck. Like, we just somewhat take the mask on, like at least have them on in case somebody tries to break in and be like, yo, cops, you know, like
that
weird
would
times.
Suck.
Pumi was there. No. Steve was there. Steve was drunk. This is the first time I really got to see Steve drinking. And
oh, man.
I knew he's got the eyes already, but after the drinking, it was 10 times worse. I was like, Steve, you gotta open your eyes.
If you wanna see me drunk, all you have to do is choke out a top 5 guy in the world. That's it. Just choke him out, and I'll get drunk with you.
Giggling in the corner, funniest thing. I got pictures of him just
I'm fucking.
Yeah, I gotta see these.
No, crazy.
I'll put them up in the pod.
Never do that.
Yeah, it was a great time, man. So that was like that's what fighting is. People think it's so easy, and they're like, oh, you fight boring. I'm like, dude, I'm fighting the fucking wind, dude. I'm not saying I'm going out to just lay on guys. I do advanced position. I do take guys down. I do try to beat them up. I do try to submit them. If the guy's just sitting there pushing against the cage and doing absolutely nothing, and the other guy's doing absolutely nothing to get off the cage, who's really at fault? I don't know. Maybe the guy should get the hell off the cage, and maybe the other guy should open up and throw a couple of strikes. But if they don't, I almost feel like the onus is on the other guys.
Well, that 100%. Look, no one wants to be stuck against the cage. Like, I think...
But the same thing. oh, he's gaming the system because he's on his hands and knees like a female, is what these people are saying in the comments about my style if I have a failed takedown attempt. Well, guess what, assholes? This ain't 1FC. We're in the UFC and we are using the unified rules. This isn't 1FC rules. Obviously, if this was 1FC, I would have to adapt and I would not take those stupid shots because I'm not gonna put myself in a position to get kneed in the head like Mighty Mouse and then after criticizing somebody like the week before, literally the week after gets knocked out cold from the same position. I'm here for violence, bro.
Villain Aljo, Steve.
But what I'm saying is, when I get to those positions, I beat people up. So it's like when people try to dog me in those positions, you're a boring wrestler. I'm like, am I actually a boring wrestler or you're just mad that I beat your favorite fighter?
Like, oh, that was good.
Which one is it? Or you just really want to see me lose?
Look, I'll say listening to like Welch and them
all again, of the above.
I got to imagine, Jesus Christ, I got to imagine O'Malley's going to have some idea, like
going
some thoughts.
Going nowhere. All
right, I got to go. I got to go see.
Going nowhere.
I got to get out of here.
We can't be stopped now because we the champions for life. We ain't going nowhere.
Ooh, they're focused.
We ain't going nowhere. We can't be stopped now.
And touch.
Shout out to Nerd Focus.
Hey.
All right. That was a good pod.
Hey, right. Like, subscribe. We'll be back soon in the Octagon.
The number one podcast in MMA. Can I say that now?
In MMA. Ah.
I think we can say that.
We give you guys the gifts.
Now that Steve's on the pod, I think it's definitely the number one pod.
I think
I'm gonna miss you next week.
Yeah.
Oh man, this guy's going. Wow, this guy's running off on us again.
You could always come to Vegas.
No, we can do one more next week before we go. We'll have time.
Yeah, but after that, you'll be missed. They hate me.
Well, Jake,
we'll have to zoom you in.
You're much better than me, so.
Wait, guys, if you want Ray Longo on the podcast, comment Ray Longo.
That's what we need to do.
We got to get Longo on here before he leaves. I think it will be awesome. Come on, you would love that.
We're trying to figure out how we're going to get him down the steps.
The steps are going to be the tough part. His hips.
Or we bring the podcast to Ray.
Ooh.
He would do that. We'll go to the gym.
It's actually not a bad idea. You know, I've never been inside Ray's house.
Whoa. Me neither.
Isn't that crazy?
I got to go to this podcast. I don't even need to be on the podcast. I would love to be.
Or Matt.
Oh! Right.
Come on, people. Get Ray and Matt on here. This is crazy.
Oh, dude, that would be sick. Wow. I would love to just watch
everyone
that live.
Yeah. Right? Come on.
Might break the interwebs.
Yo, all
right, you know the
I'm
deal.
I'm going to sit
Follow,
right there.
Comment, subscribe. Guys, I'm late. I got to go.
What are you late for?
I go see my girl, you know? It's what we do out here, Jake.
Adulting. All right, guys. See you next time. Peace.